Welcome back to another season of the Future Report podcast. My name is Ashley Fell. I am delighted to be joining you again for another season of new insights and fresh research. We have come back from a little bit of a break from the last few weeks, and we've got some really great episodes planned for this season. And we're beginning this season by thinking about the future and artificial intelligence. And although it has seemed like artificial intelligence has been on our radar for just the last couple of years, in fact, it's been something that's been talked about and considered for the last few decades. However, in recent years, it has been sort of utilized, I think, more in the background. But now, with it becoming more accessible and its use widespread, we want to discuss today what this means for the way and the type of work that we as humans will be doing in the future. And this is an important question, not just for those among us, you know, in Gen Z who may be beginning their careers, but all of us in the workforce as we think about the type of work we'll be doing in the years to come. So joining me to discuss this is McCrindle's data scientist and resident AI expert, Mike Abecina. Mike, welcome back to the podcast.
Hi, Ash, and thanks very much for having me.
No pressure, but the last time you came on, your episode has performed very well, and it was again around AI and ChatGPT with a particular focus on education. And that is, I think, even an indicator to me that this is a very popular topic at the moment. People are very keen to kind of observe people like yourselves' perspective on artificial intelligence. And of course, as a data scientist and someone who works regularly with artificial intelligence, I thought, Mike, we could begin by hearing about maybe how you feel about AI and its impact on the type of work we'll be doing in the future. Would you say you're more excited, more nervous, maybe a bit of both?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. And it really depends on how I'm feeling that day. And I think that's the case with a lot of people, to be honest. A new breakthrough is announced and we feel suddenly differently about it or excited about it. There are definitely things that are both exciting. Maybe not scary, but certainly nervous about. I might just start talking about the things that I'm excited about. So I'm really excited about how, I guess, AI and large language models will create new opportunities for work. So not just in terms of, I guess, new jobs, but also in terms of like how we work, in terms of, you know, AI being incorporated to a lot of big products like search and design. So currently I'm using AI at the moment to help write code, and it really speeds up a lot of what I'm doing. I'm also excited about the new possibilities, things that we haven't really thought of before. You and I sort of, I guess, toy with the idea of maybe getting artificial intelligence to not so much clone us, but to, I guess, replicate our image and for us to be able to, I guess, have avatars who can sort of speak on our behalf, that can translate on the fly. And while I haven't really thought of all the implications of that, it's just exciting to think about, I guess, you know, just what's possible. And that part of it is, yeah, really interesting to me. And this tech as well is so much more accessible than it used to be. I remember 5 years ago, the sorts of things that we now have access to, only, you know, the very niche research labs in America would be able to do it. 2 years ago, it was sort of like only your specialist data science team that had access to this talent and AI. But now it's just become so much more accessible, so cheap, and things are becoming more and more open sourced, which is, yeah, really exciting as well, meaning that, yeah, more developers and more people can access this technology. But before I sort of get into sort of talking about some of the things that I'm nervous about, if you don't mind, I might throw the question back at you, Ash, like how you feel about it. Are you excited, nervous, both?
Yeah, definitely both, I think. I guess like any new technology or anything that's unknown to us, we tend, I think, as humans to fear it because we don't know the implications, the opportunities, the threats. It seems like another thing we have to get our heads around or learn. And maybe that's a sign of me just getting older, because I think I remember when I was young, and I feel like it's a characteristic of young people that they're very adaptive and fluid, and they're like, oh, this new thing, great, like we have to learn it, so we'll do that. Kids today maybe using, you know, ChatGPT to help with their research, you know, that's in that more flexible, fluid part of their life where it just becomes second nature. Whereas for those of us who've got a bit more tenure or are more established in our careers or our work to have to go, oh, I have to learn this whole new thing. That was until I tried it. And then I think it probably under your advice, Mike, you know, even just having a play around with ChatGPT and very quickly becoming aware of the time savings of the, you know, especially with the time savings, therefore the way that it's opened up I guess opportunities for me to be thinking about other tasks, you know, if it's doing a bit of the manual labor or the creative thinking, and then I can come in and tweak and adapt and edit something and transform it. It does save time. So I think I'm more on the excited side of it now. And yeah, we have talked about, you know, you and I, and as you were just mentioning before, even the ability for artificial intelligence to not necessarily replace or clone us as communicators or speakers. But even that, there's that moment where you go, oh, is it going to put me out of a job? Am I really going to be, is Ashley Fell ever really going to be needed in her true human form? I don't know. But I think I do more towards the excitement side. And part of that has been even conversations with you, someone who's informed and who is helpful and gives a balanced perspective. So hopefully that's something that our listeners can glean from you as well today. Because I think there are threats that we should be aware of. It is going to change how we do things in the future, but there's also opportunities that come with that, which is exciting if we can embrace those opportunities and look at the positives. So yeah. A balanced view, I like to think.
Yeah.
But we're talking today particularly about jobs and work. I guess, Mike, I'd love to hear your perspective around how it's going to impact the different type of work or the type of jobs in the future, whether there's maybe some things that, like I said, and like you've mentioned and acknowledged, you know, are a bit of a threat or that AI is a threat to. Are there particular areas or industries that you think it's really going to disrupt, say, more than others?
I think it's quite early at this stage. And we have to acknowledge that, you know, it is early days, even though we probably hear about it a lot. And the degree to which it is a threat really, I guess, depends on us. Perhaps a better way to think about it is to think about, well, what sort of jobs will mostly benefit from this technology? And the degree to which it becomes a threat, so to speak, I guess, is largely based on how we manage that change. And I think the answer to that, like if I was to be honest, is pretty much all jobs. You see, as these models become more advanced and fine-tuned and deployed to be, I guess, quite industry-specific, it won't be long before these large language models are tuned to, you know, the specific tasks that we need to do for our job. And we're seeing this already in the likes of Duolingo, Khan Academy, Bloomberg. They already have their fine-tuned sort of large language models for their purpose and their need. And so when OpenAI, they did their own sort of internal report to get a sort of a lay of the land of what might be happening with professions as a result of their technology. One of the professions, and this is really interesting to me, one of the professions that came out as being quite, or being fully exposed to being, I guess, replaced by AI were applied mathematicians. Now, this is not the usual narrative that the workforce has experienced. The usual narrative is that it's generally, you know, high manual labor, easily repetitive tasks. However, this is quite different. It's actually seeking to augment almost all of the white collar jobs, whether it's accounting, you know, being a lawyer, doctors, tech, the finance industry, you name it. Now, I don't think anyone is saying, and I don't think, you know, with any sort of, you know, reasonable clout, no one is saying that lawyers are all going to be a thing of the past. Rather, what we're seeing is that these large language models and foundation models have the potential to make the greatest impact in these industries, which I think is exciting. But at the same time, like, I want to acknowledge that there are some negative impacts that AI will have on our work. And we are currently seeing this within the creative industries, you know, whether it's sort of marketing, copy, or creative art. You know, content creators writers and artists are becoming more and more exposed to having, I guess, their sort of design ethic and or their design sort of approach being stolen by these AI models, so that they're able to, you know, scan this image or scan this artist's work and be able to replicate it. And we've seen this recently with music, right, where we had, I think in the last sort of fortnight, you had this song by a ghostwriter dropping, you know, music from Drake and The Weeknd on this collaboration, which apparently is this absolute banger of a tune, but isn't written by either of them, and had to be taken down. And you have a company like Stability AI that's being accused of having, I guess, you know, taken images from a lot of these sort of image warehouses to train their own models. And so I guess with, you know, more and more AI content being out there, yeah, these creators are going to have to really pave their own way and really standing out. And so I guess, you know, is that a threat? I guess to some extent, yes, it is, but it's also an opportunity for that industry to pivot.
I've seen the AI music generated or AI generated music, musicians, songs on TikTok in the last few weeks. And it's interesting because at the moment, some of them sound a little bit AI-ish. They don't sound like the artist if you know the artist and you listen to the artist a lot. However, it's, I think, the part of the scary component of artificial intelligence is that's evolving so quickly and it's changing and it's constantly improving on itself. So it won't be long till it's really very sophisticated, but it's fascinating to see. And it's interesting what you were saying as well around the types or the industries that are, I guess, being threatened by AI, like lawyers, I guess, because I was at a conference recently and a fellow kind of thought leader was sharing with me, he said, is AI and, you know, the evolution of AI models like ChatGPT, does that mean the death of the knowledge economy? And I was like, whoa, clickbaity statement, but an interesting one to think about. Have you ever heard it be put like that, or have you seen any commentary around similar ideas or concepts?
Yeah, totally. And I think that it comes back to that, you know, it's so easy for this content to be generated and for it to just simply flood, you know, the market with AI generated sort of media. Some companies have taken some really interesting approaches. So The Chaser, which is the, you know, the Australian media outlet, have decided to put all their writing behind the paywall because they've come to terms with the fact, and I think they said it quite comedically, that AI can write better than all their writers. And so we need to protect ourselves as long as we can, and have put all their content behind the paywall. And even what we're seeing with the writers' strike, so the writers' strike happening at the moment in the United States, you know, there are quite a few demands around pay, but one of the demands is around limiting the exposure of AI to, you know, creating stories, writing stories. And you can imagine it for the editor of these, you know, for editors of shows, having to just wade through, you know, mediocre AI-generated content that's just multiplied by thousands and thousands just to be able to get the right story. Yeah, so I guess there is this potential for, you know, AI-generated content, yes, very easily available, but also, yeah, quite a pain to manage as well.
Yeah, absolutely. It's really interesting. And if anyone is listening to the podcast and they find themselves in the camp of feeling maybe a little bit nervous or viewing it more as a threat, I thought it might be helpful to let you know that you're not alone. And even our research conducted just at the beginning of this year, when we knew a lot less about artificial intelligence, even than we know now, just a few months later, we conducted a nationally representative study of Australians, and we tested the statement, I am nervous that artificial intelligence will replace human jobs. And 74% of Australians agreed with that statement to some extent, whether it was strongly, somewhat, or slightly. And then when we segmented that research by generation, that 74% increased to 82% among Generation Z, who are, I guess, looking at their career and their life and thinking, okay, this is going to impact my whole career, rather than those of us who are a third, a quarter, whatever it might be, you know, through our careers. So It's really interesting. There's definitely a little bit of hesitation or viewing it as transformative. And also, I just think it's interesting what you shared as well, Mike, just around the types of jobs that we think or that we thought previously it was going to replace. Like, I feel like our discourse around this or our commentary was that it's the repetitive, it's the manual, those tasks that a computer can automate, it will automate. But now it is erring towards more of that, those types of skills or jobs that we thought only a human can do, those distinctively human characteristics, you know, a machine can't replicate. But now we are starting to see that it can replicate some of those things. So it's interesting to view all of that in this context.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that when it comes to thinking about, I guess, the future of work, it would be good to sort of think through, I guess, for companies and for people, what some of the concerns are around this AI, which I think is good when we're sort of discussing, you know, what sort of jobs people might be doing in the future. So some concerns that I have that come to mind when it comes to this AI include like a lack of transparency about how these models are being created. So there's a lot of bias in how these models may have been made, and there's a large carbon footprint that they leave. There's potential for, I guess, minorities to be marginalized because, you know, a lot of this training data is pretty Western sort of data, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And I guess, you know, in terms of thinking about what, I guess, jobs might appear in the future as a result of this, being aware of what these concerns are is important for people to, I guess, know how to approach, I guess, implementing AI in a sort of really informed way. I was reading on LinkedIn, right? I saw this article recently claiming that AI has better bedside manner than a medical professional in delivering medical advice. And, you know, at one level, you sort of think, oh, great, you know, AI is here again to take my job. But all you have to do is just read the original article and see that it was based on like a Reddit post. So it wasn't even based on real medical advice. It was just based on what people had responded to on Reddit. So not even like, you know, person-to-person interaction. So there was no actual indication of what the diagnosis was. And yet people share this article while signaling, I guess, the end of the medical profession, you know, which perhaps speaks to, I guess, how uneasy we feel about this current moment where any sign of AI outperforming humans spells the end of humanity, which I just don't think is a helpful narrative to promulgate, you know. So I guess as we sort of start thinking about, you know, what sort of jobs might be created as a result of this, yeah, getting a good understanding of what some of the concerns are around AI, yeah, is also really important.
Yeah, and I think I know we talked about this a little bit a few weeks ago, even just around one of the sessions that you were conducting for an education provider, even just helping leaders of that organization be aware of how or what camp their team might fit into, just around their openness. And like, I think it's important, like you said, to, of course, at a bigger societal level, to be aware of the challenges and the biases and all those things that exist within this conversation. But even just the people within our team, it's helpful to know, or our families, you know, how people feel and how we can help them, you know, move forward into a future. So there's that component, there's the threat side that we've discussed. But I guess the inverse of that is like anything, hopefully, that is created, especially around technology, that it with it creates new jobs or careers or job opportunities. I'd be keen to hear, Mike, from your perspective and what you've read and seen, what sort of careers do you think might, you know, increase in demand? Is it the people who can, I guess, code or populate AI, or is that also being replaced by AI? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, no, that's great. I think that to some extent, yeah, more specialists in this area, as more companies seek to adopt this, people with, I guess, professional experience in building, deploying AI, that's going to be so important. We're certainly not at the stage, and this is again something that you hear a lot, where coders are going to be replaced by AI. We're like not even close to that yet. No one has really sort of made those moves. And so as I guess, machine learning and artificial intelligence become more and more important, those jobs are still certainly going to be on the rise. But also what's going to be on the rise are, I guess, relationships, jobs that require, I guess, relationships and sort of building relationships within organizations and, you know, being strong on empathy. Like, AI is really good at mimicking warmth and really good at mimicking empathy, but it actually doesn't have any empathy and warmth. And we know that people are going to need that more and more as things become a lot more, how do you say it, automated and a lot more where we're unsure whether a thing has been written by a human or not. We as people just crave that human connection. And so it's going to become more, how do you say it, popular and in demand and necessary as a society for us to function. Also, those who have industry experience. So, you know, it's one thing to know a lot about artificial intelligence, but it's another thing to know about how AI might be applied to this particular industry, whether it's education, finance, whether it's medicine, health. So as AI gets more and more popular, we're going to require that, how do you say it, that industry expertise to know how to plug that value into that particular industry. And then lastly, I can see that, you know, especially with, you know, waves of content sort of coming through with AI generated, you know, stories or poems, it's actually going to be those who know how to craft a really good story who are going to stand out. So it won't be enough to, you know, show that you can write and write a lot and write well. You know, the demand will be for really creative writers who have really got ingenuity, real craftsmanship around how they craft stories, because ultimately that is what's going to make these, I guess, this content stand out from these AI models. Yeah.
Yeah, that's really great advice. And perhaps even as well, I think, really natural for us to be thinking about the knowledge economy, but also, I guess, because I know that we're even thinking about and potentially about to embark on some, well, revisiting some research we conducted as an organization a few years ago, even around the vocational education sector. But of course, those more tactile, tangible courses that we see at TAFEs as well around builders and electricians and hairdressers, all those things, I guess, outside of knowledge economy may even have impacts on how parents, how students view those sorts of careers as well, potentially.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it's exciting stuff. And you mentioned it there, Mike, as well, just around, I guess, more of a focus on the skills that we need to thrive in the future. And I mean, to no one's surprise, we're playing a bit of a futurist game here where we predict the impact of artificial intelligence, even though, of course, there's no exact science. But we can know more about, I guess, the trends and the way things are going rather than predicting the exact careers or the exact career pathways that are going to be at a higher, level of disruption or level of threat from artificial intelligence. But oftentimes, I think lately, the conversation around choosing a career path is less about choosing a career or a job and more about developing a suite of skills that allow you to move around different industries and jobs and careers, because we know that we're talking about a very career mobile generation of students coming through, that the nature of their jobs is changing through lots of different trends beyond even just technology. But of course, technology plays a huge part in that, which is the conversation we're having today. So I'd be keen to hear, Mike, you mentioned there empathy as a big one, which is great because I feel like that's what we're telling people in our presentations and our consulting. It's empathy and critical thinking and creativity, some of those things that you mentioned there. Do you think that's still going to be true as we move to a more machine-assisted AI future, that these are the skills that will be increasingly important for kids, students, people to develop?
So, yeah, about that empathy and the ability to relate more and more so, especially when it comes to change, especially when it comes to, I guess, you know, adapting to something that you don't know, where we have done, I guess, a job or, you know, business has carried on in the past, you know, quite successfully using older techniques and having to adapt to new things, in order to be able to change people's minds and in order for people to see, I guess, the pros and cons of adapting to this new way of working, absolutely it will require people who listen and who care for the people that they are leading and the industries that they are serving. But it will also require a lot of the analytical skills to actually evaluate whether, you know, is AI actually the suitable tool that we need right now? And it might be the case, and I can see, you know, real examples of this happening where AI won't be the silver bullet that everyone hopes it will be, especially in areas like education or health, where we need that human-to-human interaction. And having that, I guess, sensitivity towards, I guess, what the real human need is and what society's needs are, which is, I guess, you know, that sort of global citizen sort of empathy that we talk about, is going to be really important for, I guess, the success of these AI initiatives and for people not to be alienated by, I guess, these, you know, AI sort of interventions. But I guess in addition to those skills, I can certainly see that when it comes to using AI and people being successful in its adoption, experimentation is also going to be a really key skill. And we're not really used to talking about experimentation as a skill, but if you've ever used any sort of generative AI product, whether it's Midjourney, ChatGPT, there's a whole lot of trial and error. And for some people, that's really frustrating. They like to own the process from start to finish. They want to be in control of, and it's, you know, it's very similar to how we currently use computers at the moment, where you have your mouse and you click on one point and then click on the next and suddenly you've got a document or whatever it might be. Generative AI is very different, where you basically, you know, start with a totally left of field prompt and it's able to generate something really close to what you want, but it's never quite exact. And so you have to edit it. And that back and forth of experimentation is going to be, quite an important, how do you say it? Not so much a skill, but an attitude that we have to have, recognizing that the end result might actually be a whole lot better. And it's that experimentation, that back and forth, which sort of leads me to talk about, I guess, collaboration as being a really important skill to also develop. And when I say collaboration, yes, it's definitely collaboration between person to person, but it's collaboration between us and AI. And we have this saying at McCrindle of humanity AI, where we think that, you know, AI works best when there is a human in the loop. And we've seen that in terms of how models have been developed, but also in the workplace, it's going to be more and more the case where actually being able to know when AI is a great co-pilot for a particular activity and when it's actually not, you know? And lastly, I think it's, you know, when it comes to any of these sorts of initiatives, understanding the business is really important. So having a real business driven mindset that isn't just about, you know, learning the shiniest new toy, but it's actually about, you know, how is this going to bring value to my business, value to my customers? Is this going to make me more customer obsessed or is it just going to make me more distracted? And I think that if it does the first one, then it's going to be successful. However, we need people who are that, who show that, I guess, initiative and that entrepreneurship.
Yeah, absolutely. They're really great skills to be focusing on. And the other one I was thinking of as you were talking is probably also something that is timeless that humans have always needed. And as you get older, you realize this even more and you develop it naturally, is resilience as well. Like just around the ability to adapt and change, or in like the worst case scenario, if one day someone's job does get made redundant because of developments in artificial intelligence, to have that resilience and the thick skin to go, okay, well, how do I pivot? How do I change? How can I upskill? Where do I go next? And, you know, unforeseen things, events, pandemics come at us all the time, rising interest rates. And so having that resilience is something I think that, yeah, we're really, and I know the education sector is also really keen to instill in the next generation as they think about a very mobile sort of future work life, especially in light of all the things we're talking about today. So interesting. And Mike, let's get personal. You're a former teacher, you're a dad, and now you're someone working at McCrindle where we're constantly, you know, surveying society and trends and predicting the future. You're going out and advising schools and organisations around some of the things that we're talking about today. So I'd be keen to hear, as we wrap up, what kind of advice you would give to someone, whether they're looking to start or perhaps are even evaluating their career, about just AI and the future of work. Is there any things that you're thinking about for your own kids, or if you were mentoring someone, in light of all that you know and your experience, what advice you would give to them regarding AI and the future of work or the future of their work?
Oh, yeah. Now I've got so much, so many things. It's hard to contain it, to be honest. And I guess it's because I've had so many different spheres, as you mentioned, like being a teacher, a former teacher, and a dad. If I put my teacher hat on, like, I would think that if you're being exposed to ChatGPT or whatever, like, learn how it works. And I think that if you're in education and you're a teacher, I think, it's not so much your responsibility, but it really would enhance, I guess, the adoption of AI if you were educated in how the AI actually works. Like, how does a transformer work? You know, with the GPT, what does the T mean? And, you know, stuff like that. I think that... That is certainly an opportunity for, I guess, students who are wanting to know more about it. And that's the first question, like, when they see something amazing, it's like, how does it do that? I guess equipping people with that knowledge of how it works is, I guess, an important thing. I guess for some of our listeners who are perhaps a little scared and feel quite nervous, I also want to share that sentiment that you know, as I mentioned earlier, it depends on the day. As a bit of encouragement, I want to say that your imagination is endless and AI's imagination isn't. So if you think about how artificial intelligence is trained, so it learns on finite data sets and it's programmed with, you know, finite number of attention heads and layers and all this sort of stuff. But the human creativity is just limitless and boundless. And so I think we should, I guess, you know, really lean into that as a really important part of, I guess, you know, our own sort of, how do you say it, satisfaction in living. And take comfort in knowing that, you know, AI is only going to be good at copying us. It's not going to be great at leading us into, I guess, new ideas that we'd never really thought of before. So, really lean into that and cultivate, I guess, you know, habits that allow you to explore your imagination and to be able to create out of that imagination. I'll say also, you know, this is probably also stepping back from the skills, but more around who we are to be as people. Be everything that AI isn't, you know, like, care about people, show an interest in people's lives. People are going to need that more and more. Initiate contact, you know, be generous with your time and affections and be present with people. People are going to need that more and people are going to want that more. And you know, AI can't supply that. As much as it tries to, it's only ever mimicry. It's never authentic. And the last thing I'd say is, and it's great that when you mentioned that stat about Gen Z being even more, how do you say it, nervous about its adoption, don't be a passenger in this time. You know, ask big questions like, is this, and this is a question I haven't really heard asked, but I don't know why we aren't, is this a future that we want? You know, some would say that we're sort of powerless to stop the tide. But we've seen people, when they gather together, can achieve great things, especially, you know, younger ones. And so if it is something that you feel like, you know, actually, I'm a little nervous about how quick AI is moving, or I think AI needs a little bit more regulation in the space that I'm operating, then, you know, lobby for change. Lobby for guardrails to be put in place, because any sort of regulation at this stage would be helpful. It would help innovation move forward without it sort of, you know, going way off course. So, yeah, there are my bits of advice.
Wow, that was very motivational and inspirational. I feel so empowered with agency to go out now and have imagination and be curious. They were some of the things I was kind of taking away, but then you kept talking and I was trying to write down everything and all these amazing like one-liners, like, be everything AI isn't. I'm like, wow, write that on my wall at home or something for the future. But no, really great wisdom, really great like information, but also I think delivered with great empathy for those who might be a little bit more on the nervous side, but also a really great balance of getting us and our listeners and me personally as well excited about the future. So thank you so much for your time today, Mike, for your expertise and for dropping all that wisdom.
No worries. It's always great to be here.
And if people would like to stay up to date with your work, Mike, at McCrindle, of course, they can find you on LinkedIn. They can head to our articles section of our website, which you've got written some great pieces around artificial intelligence. And if you just in general like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to this podcast. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com to find out more. So as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.